Chid, I also want to thank Dr. Agarwal for actually co-opting us as a co-organizer. So first, thanks to Dr. Agarwal and also giving me the opportunity. Mr. Lakshmi Kumaran was supposed to speak, but he's busy in the courts yesterday and he couldn't come. So what I really want to do today is basically for the Indian audience, and we've been talking about patents, patents, patents. I would be digressing and talking about the Biological Diversity Act in India. I know there's no time, so I won't talk about the plant variety development or the PVP protection that we have in this country. Basically, why do I want to talk about the Biodiversity Act in India? It's very important. We know that more than 70% of the Indian population is dependent on agriculture. And therefore, this Biodiversity Act really becomes very important when we do any patent protection that we want for our bioresources. And therefore, basically, it really stems from the patents that I talk about. Because in the Indian Patent Act, we do have a clause that we need to provide the source and geographical origin of biological resources that we are using. It need not be what we are claiming for. You could be using a biological resources for testing, you could be using a biological resources for isolation of genes or chemicals, or like different companies in using, or it could be agricultural companies. And because of this requirement of giving the source and geographical origin of the bioresources that you use, bioresources can be anything. It could be microorganisms, viruses, plants, animals, insects, mosquitoes, anything, anything that you use. A non-disclosure of the source and geographical origin, or a wrong disclosure of the source and geographical origin in the patent specification, can lead to revocation. So I think this is very important, not only for the Indians who are drafting patents or getting the grant of the patents, but also we are getting these objections in all applications, whether it is by multinationals, whether it's been filed by universities abroad, that you have to disclose the source and geographical origin of bioresources used in your thing. There is one more hurdle that the Indians face, which the foreigners don't face. So that is what I'm going to really talk about today. What is this? Why? Why are we discriminating? So if you are an Indian university or CSIR or an Indian multinational or an Indian company and using an Indian bioresource and filing a patent application, you need NBA approval, which is the National Biodiversity Authority approval. So everyone, whether you're government, CSIR, DST, IITs, Indian companies, foreign companies, using any bioresource, you need NBA approval. So this is where I'm really starting with, and therefore I feel that this is one of the areas that we have really missed out. Definitely, we have not talked much about trademark and copyright, but this is so inherently important in the patent landscape, especially with biological resources, biotechnology, chemistry, pharma, and so on. We have enacted the Indian Biodiversity Act. And it actually was a fallout of the CBD, so I won't go. But basically, the objectives of the Biodiversity Act is to conserve the biological diversity in India. There's things about concept of prior informed consent, and we also have to sustainably use our bioresources. I would directly go into the Biodiversity Act in India. And I said this is very important for the patent, and that is why it is important that we see who and what really is this Biological Diversity Act in India. Section 3 of this act is very important, and it says that any person or any company having a foreign holding in an Indian company or in having its source in India and working in India will have to get NBA approval for access of biological resources. I don't want to spend too much time, I just want to give it here, is prior approval of the NBA is required for access of biological resources. Not for Indian companies, not for Indian residents, but if you are a company and an Indian company having any foreign holding, or your director is a foreigner, a non-Indian, a resident Indian is also considered a foreigner under the Biodiversity Act. So any of these, and we have examples of several multinationals working in India, maybe in different areas, I don't want to name them, will have to go to NBA to get prior approval for even accessing the biological resource. And what do they use this biological resource? It's not for eating, it is not for trading, but it is for any research, commercial utilization, or biosurvey and biotilization. A research, as all of us know, it can be any systematic study, any research that you do. So any company, not an Indian company, not an Indian citizen, not an Indian institute, no CSIR. You don't need NBA approval for access, but you definitely need NBA approval if your company has even one foreign shareholding. And today, with this globalization, many Indian companies do have some foreign shareholding, or they could have a foreign director, or and so on. They all need NBA approval for research, commercial utilization, biosurvey, and biotilization. I've given some examples here. I would next go, so you definitely need access, approval for access of any bioresource. And bioresource could be plants, animals, microorganisms, and so on, and including the genetic material. They've excluded human genetic material. So that is the one. Another section, that is section 4 of the Act, is for transfer of research results. So if I'm an Indian company or an Indian institute, and I want to transfer my research results could be data, research results could be product, anything that I transfer within India from an Indian institute to another foreign company or any other Indian company having a foreign holding in it, then I need to get prior approval. So let's look at IIT. I'm just talking about IIT Delhi or IIT Mumbai, doing extremely good work. They have a patent, or they have some data, they have a research project, and they want to transfer this to, say, Unilever or PNG. They need to get approval from the National Biodiversity Authority if there is anything related to bioresources or biotechnology or pharma, wherever there is a biotechnology or bioresource used in it. So this is again very important, no transfer of research results, and this transfer of research could also be data which is going from one computer sitting in India to a computer outside of India. So we have to be very careful that there cannot be transfer of research results from an Indian company, an Indian institute, or an Indian resident to a non-resident Indian or a company having any foreign shareholding in it. This is basically, but anything that I want to publish, so what happens? I mean, CSIR publishes, IIT publishes, that is also data going out. However, the Act says any data going out in the form of publications is not a problem because it is to the public domain and you have no problem. And therefore, research, results of research, as I said, data, findings, end product, anything through research cannot move from an Indian company to a non-Indian company. But I said that you can, publications and journals can, you can, no problem. I just want to take this, the next one, I have missed some, but I just want three key points that I wanted to talk, and one of it is Section 6 of the Act. And that Section 6 of the Act is what I actually started with, that anybody using Indian bioresources, it could be an Indian company, it could be an Indian institute, it could be an Indian person, any single inventor who is an Indian inventor using Indian bioresources will have to go to NBA to get prior approval before the grant of the patent. When you file a patent application, no problem. And this section does not discriminate between Indian and non-Indian, Indian and foreigners. Anyone applying for a patent in India using Indian bioresources will have to get prior approval. So IITs, CSIR, TERI, Tata Energy, anyone will have to go to NBA to get prior approval before the grant of the patent if they use Indian bioresources. So this is very important, and they will not give you the approval unless you sign an agreement, and this is very important. It is an MOU, and they impose the benefit sharing fees there. It could be, or it could be royalty, or it could be both. Now, when you go and ask for research, I said we need access for any Indian bioresources by foreigners. You need approval, you need approval for the access of bioresources. But this Section 6 says that any patents that you file before the grant, whether you're an Indian or a non-Indian, if you use Indian bioresources, you need to get approval from NBA. In Indian companies, when I started, I said under Section 3, only foreign companies, non-resident Indians, have to get prior approval from the NBA for access of any Indian bioresources. However, if you're an Indian company, wholly Indian, Indian institute, or an Indian working on any bioresources, you have to intimate to the State Biodiversity Board. And this is very important, and this is what it is for any Indian biological resources. However, when do you want to intimate? When you're doing biosurvey and biotilization, or biosurvey and biotilization for commercial utilization. All research activities and all biosurvey and biotilizations are not covered. So if you are an Indian company and you're using bioresources, you have to be careful and you have to go to the state biodiversity approved authorities and intimate them. There are some things which are excluded, and the normal traded commodities are excluded. Growers, Hakims, and all are excluded. Collaboration between two institutes are excluded. And we have the Section 40, which has more than 190 species, which are excluded from this list. However, when we think it's an exclusion and no sections of this act will apply, but that is not the case. For the National Biodiversity Authority has made it very clear that if you use any Indian bioresources, if it is for trading, you're exempted. But if you do research, you do commercial utilization, or you do biosurvey and biotilization, you have to go to NBA, even if they are in the exemption list, and get prior approval. So I don't want to take too much time, but this is very important. The reason is it's all a fallout of the CBD, and basically it is for access and benefit sharing. And in the Section 21, it clearly says what is the manner of benefit sharing. The Government of India, NBA, has to come out with guidelines. They have had several meetings to come out with guidelines for benefit sharing, but we've not really had a final guidelines on what this benefit sharing is and what could be the amount that they would ask, and so on. So this is really a place, it's about 10 years that this act is in place, but there are still a lot of things that are really not clear to either the Indian companies, Indian institute, foreign companies, and so on. And this is can be quite a problematic case. What are the consequences of non-compliance? When approval by the NBA is required for use of biological resources occurring in India, it doesn't say origin of India, it says occurring in India. And if such approval is not obtained, the punishment can extend to 5 years imprisonment or a fine of 10 lakh rupees or both. And nowadays, the state biodiversity authorities have become very, very active in this area. We've had letters from the Madhya Pradesh State Biodiversity Authority, and the secretary of the NBA said that Madhya Pradesh State Biodiversity Board has actually stopped mining. Why? Anybody doing coal mining, they said, hey, look, you're using our bio resources, come to me for approval, and also you need to pay back royalties. I mean, it's come to that extent that coal has also become a bio resource. And this is, I heard this from the National Biodiversity Authority. It is not made up by me. So mining is everything, though it really doesn't cover coal, it doesn't cover elements, it doesn't cover the mining industry, but everyone is getting getting affected by the National Biodiversity Authority and the State Biodiversity Authority. We've also had other state biodiversity authorities like the Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and others who are going after people, asking them for, have you got prior approval? So it's very important if you're an Indian company, an Indian institute, an individual working, and you're using bioresource, you need to intimate. If you're filing patents, you need to get prior approval. And if you're a foreign national, a foreign company, or even an Indian company having one share of a foreign foreigner, or a director being a foreigner, it's considered as a foreign company, you need to get prior approval or from the NBA for access of bioresources. So with this, I want to stop. And it's just, the only one thing is, if you are applying for a plant variety protection under the PPVFRA, you do not need to go to NBA for approval. However, you need to go to NBA for approval for access of biological resource if you're a foreign company. So if you are filing for protection under the PVP Act, you do not need to get approval, because the PVP Act, it inherently has access and benefit sharing clauses in it. Thank you.